So good morning. My name is Frank van Dunn. I was asked by Professor Hopper to give some thoughts on crime and punishment. I will do so, although I'm a rather sunny character and I do not like to talk about all these dark things, but I'll do my best. Now, I start with approximately the same point that Professor Hopp chose, but I'll introduce it slightly differently just to make the connection with my topic a bit clearer. If you ask about the meaning of the word crime, you're obviously referred to the Latin, as in so many cases, crimen. But the meaning of crimen in Latin is a bit different than the word crime, because crimen, plural crimina, simply means a matter that is open or awaiting decision or resolution. So it is, in fact, anything that has yet to be settled that is a crimina. And the solution is, of course, a discrimen, which in Latin refers to the marking of a boundary, a separation, and therefore a discrimination is, in a sense, the solution to a crimen. It solves the confused state of affairs by drawing clear boundaries through it, by revealing, as it were, the structure below the confusion. It is as if you see an indiscriminate shape in the fog, and then the fog lifts, and you can discriminate exactly what is there. So the crimen approach leads to a much broader definition of the subject of crime and punishment than the modern one, which adds, let's say, an element of intentionality in some cases. A crime is an intentional violation of law, right? And then the question is, what law are we talking about? Carries the notion of punishment within itself, and the crime is defined as a punishable offense. And that raises the question of punishment. Punishment is, in fact, usually thought of as an act that would be a crime if it were not in response to a crime. So it's if a crime is a negation of law, then punishment merely compounds the negation but does not solve it. So in that sense, crime and punishment are on the same side, the negative side of things, so to speak. But let's return to this notion of crimen, the something that awaits or requires a decision or a resolution. In other words, a state of confusion or disorder. And we have, in this sense, a concept that covers all interpersonal concepts, conflicts, right? And it was interpersonal conflict that Professor Hopper was talking about in the previous lecture. Now, if you look at the causes he gave, I will just shortly repeat them using a slightly different terminology. You will find that every interpersonal conflict involves four elements. One is there have to be several persons, so a plurality of persons. These persons have to have differences in their intentions, their values, their preferences, their beliefs, whatnot. So there's an element of diversity involved. Third, there must be something which makes the conflict a hard one rather than just an intellectual difference of opinion, and these are these scarce resources, scarce means of action, which are moreover accessible to the parties in the conflict or the potential conflict. They can all have access, to the same resources which they intend to use for different purposes and for different things. Now, one element that needs to be stressed, that is that considered from any person's point of view, every other person may be considered a scarce resource, right? Just as you yourself consider in your intrapersonal choices, you consider yourself a scarce resource. Am I going to Bodrum or am I going to stay home and work? These are things that involve your own scarce resource, your time and your body, your physical energy, and so on. Now, I consider these four causes, plurality, diversity, scarcity, and access, as necessary and jointly sufficient conditions for a world of conflict, or at least potential conflict. There has, of course, to be a triggering event, but we're talking about the potentiality, the possibility of conflict here. Now, if you remove a necessary cause, then of course the consequence, in this case, the potentiality for conflict disappears. So there are, in theory, four pure solutions to interpersonal conflict. And one is the institution of unity, which removes plurality, and which involves usually the elimination of one or more, all except one, of the parties as an independent decision-making center, therefore forcing the others into the position of precisely a resource at the discretion of the one remaining decision-making authority. This unity solution is, of course, very popular both in politics and in other organizational affairs. People like to set up organizations in which they command the other people in it. Now, whether they are voluntary members or not, that is not the question here. The fact is, unity is a type of solution to interpersonal conflict, and it's a very popular, very widely used, and in some cases, highly respected type of solution. Now, the second type of solution of interpersonal conflict emerges when you attack, as it were, the factor of diversity. You do that, or you can do that in many ways, but there are traditional concepts, for example, like consensus or conformism, which express this disappearance of diversity very well. So you have a situation where all the participants share enough presuppositions about values and things to do and preferences and beliefs and how the world is put together that they can always, in the fairly short run, come to an agreement about what is the right way to act. And for example, in political philosophy, the classical notion of the polis left by Aristotle was precisely that the polis was viable because it was a community based on the consensus of families that had intermarried over long periods and long generations and raised their children in the same tradition, so that everybody, in fact, had the same deep consensus about everything. And this could be exploited whenever a specific problem arose, so that there was agreement on the propriety of any course of action before there was action to be taken. Now, these two types, consensus and unity, obviously operate on the persons involved in the original equation, so to speak, of conflict. No mention was made of scarce resources apart from the persons themselves. So the other two types of solutions, or pure solutions, conceptually speaking, to the problem of interpersonal conflict address precisely the question of the scarcity of resources. And the most popular, let's call it the natural law solution, which Professor Hope described, consists of considering the world not as A, domain of persons, and B, a domain of scarce resources with no connections between them. You look at the world as the human world in which every scarce resource is connected at present and was connected in the past to the actions of specific human beings. So that it would be possible, at least in theory, and if you kept your records straight, to say whose resource this is, and everything would, as it were, every scarce resource would be assigned to its proper owner. And this would avoid the problem of conflict in the sense that the access to scarce resources has at least conceptually a solution. Problems of enforcement I leave aside for the moment. They exist in every type of solution, of course, not just in the natural law or property type solution. The last solution is the most radical one. I'm not going to discuss it further. It is simply to assume away a scarcity or to say, well, we can solve all problems if we have an abundance of everything, right? Now, that solution, you may think of, for example, the final stages of communism as promised by Marx. No problem of scarcity anymore, not even a problem of scarcity in social affairs, because there would be enough ways for everybody to fulfill his potential beyond present expectations, no constraints whatsoever. Now, these four types of solutions, or let's say three, unity, consensus, and the property related solution, correspond to familiar structures in sociological literature, and even in common speech, which I call, on the one hand, the society type, which is the unity solution, societies being organizations, les sociétés, les societas, organizations that set themselves goals and organize activities among their members or their employees or maybe their slaves, if they have slaves, whatever, their dogs, their social property, things that belong to the society in order to achieve their goals. Right? It's a very familiar structure. In fact, it's probably the structure that's most in the news, in the media, right? Because being hierarchical structures, societies have someone at the top whom you can talk to and who will speak for the whole society. With communities, it's a bit different. Communities are flat. They have no hierarchy. There are positions, persons of eminence, greater eminence and lesser eminence, or no eminence at all in communities. But communities are generally devoid of any commanding structure. Now, if you look at the natural law solution, where do you find it? Well, I call it by a special name because English, unfortunately, seems to have no commonly used word to indicate it. I call it the convivial order, and that is just to honor my own language, which has a word for the convivial order, namely the samenleving, the living together, hence convivere in Latin, hence convivial order, my suggestion for English. Now, each of these orders is claimed by some people, at least, to be respectable. Societies, at least, is the major figures in it. The leaders claim the order of their society to be respectable. Members in the community regard their community as respectable. Otherwise, they would not long stay in it, because communities are fairly easy to exit from, at least most of them. And the convivial order is also respectable, although it has no spokesman and it has no cultural identity. So who are the eminent members in the convivial order? That's very different. Yet it is that sort of order that is usually presupposed in a libertarian or extreme radical liberal discourse. It's the field where you talk about people regardless of their social and their cultural identities. Right? So you can there see the relationship of person to person, unadorned by all sorts of titles, which are common in communities and in societies. There are no rabbis in the convivial order, there is just a person who has interest in religion, and there are no directors in the convivial order. There are just people minding their own business. So you have here this reality of interactions that is very vital, because we are constantly interacting with strangers or people who are half strangers, and with whom we have very little, if anything, cultural or social in common. So yet we deal with them according to the general principles of human intercourse, and these have to be justified, or rather defended, independently of all the cultural, religious, traditional, customary assumptions, the legal documents, the statutes, and the constitutions of, on the one hand, communities, and on the other hand, societies. So this is a typical philosophical problem. How do you identify this convivial order where everywhere you look, the eye is drawn, as it were, to social constructs and to community identities? Now, if a crime is a of the convivial order, and another crime is a negation of the community order, of this or that community order, and still another crime of this or that social order, then of course you are referring to very, very different things. You cannot hope to have a single set of arguments if you are discussing crime or punishment, for that matter, many other things also, if the people you are discussing with are presupposing a different context of human interaction than you are. If you are, I noticed that, well, Walter Block was not here, but I once helped him publishing a series of lectures on economics and religion, and many of the authors in his collection of papers wrote from within a particular perspective, a particular society or a particular community. For example, he had many people writing on Jewish economics, right? And they were, of course, presupposing everything that it means to be Jewish in the relevant sense, committed to certain moral and religious principles, for example. But if you then move in and with a purely free market discourse, such as Walter Block would use, then of course these people find that they are not being answered on the questions they were raising, because they were raising their questions within a particular context, and this context is simply denied. So that leaves the vexing problem, really. If we are confronting many types of order, in this case the convivial order and the community order and the social orders, how do we rank their prescriptions, so to speak? Now, one thing that sets the convivial order apart is that its law, which I call the natural law, despite what Marco Bassani said about natural law, I think the concept can be defined. It is not just a fig leaf for ideologies. The concept can be defined. Natural law can be argued in any context. It makes, apart from logic and the general truths about the physical world and the capacities of human persons, hardly any contestable or controversial presupposition. So it is something that can be argued quite generally. But this is not the case when you are talking with people within a community or within a society, because then they will bring in their own norms and rules and so on. And then the question is, can these rules be justified outside the particular community? Because you can always agree with people you agree if, and then there's very little need to have any argumentation or any discussion at all. So the notion of crime depends on the context. And if you look at the different contexts in their hierarchy, you see that they are not just three concepts of orders that can be put together in any arbitrary way. You find that the principles of natural law can be applied, not in any community or society, because there are communities and society that violate principles of natural law. But on the other hand, you can have communities that are in compliance with the natural law, only adding their own cultural elements to it, or societies are in compliance with natural law requirements, only adding their own requirements to those of the natural law. And then the whole question is, how do we determine what is compatible or not compatible? And the argument that I'd like to make is that the notion of crime, in the sense of the natural, an offense, a violation of the natural law, is in any case the primary consideration. It indicates what used to be called the mala in se, things that are bad in themselves, so in contrast with things that are merely mala prohibita, things that are bad because they are forbidden by some rule or custom or tradition. Now, when a rule exists and it forbids something, but the rule is itself in compliance with natural law requirements, then you can imagine that there are within communities or societies sanctions applied to these prohibited things, even though in the context where you are not inside the community or inside the society, you would have no argument for applying the sanction. Now, the element of punishment I have not yet mentioned, but let's talk, just to restrict it, because I have only a few minutes left, to natural order situation, to the convivial order situation, natural law problem. If there is a crime, that is a violation of law, that does not necessarily trigger the idea, there must be punishment, for the very simple reason that many violations of law occur without malicious intent, without the person wanting to commit a crime. It happens by accident, unintentionally, carelessness, whatever. And the harm done to the order of law is objectively done, but to punish the person would introduce or would have to be justified with the principle saying, in effect, that it is all right to treat a person as a criminal, even if he has not had the intention to be a criminal. So against his own will, but that is a very vague expression here. So the criminal act, in the sense of a crimen, could be a simple tort, and it would have to be solved by the usual remedies in tort, which are restitution, compensation, and things like that. Now, if that is the solution for torts where there is no malicious intent, the question is, what happens when there is malicious intent? And here, the answer would have to be, what do you mean by proof that there was malicious intent? Because there may be an act in anger, right? And then the person repents immediately. Right? He breaks your door, and then the next moment he says, sorry, here is money. I'll buy you a new door, and just come with me to the shop, and we'll settle matters. Is there then still an occasion to punish? No, because by the time the punishment would have to be inflicted, the harm would have been redressed. So in conclusion, I would say that punishment, the question of punishment arises only at the moment where there is no longer a possibility that, or not just a possibility, where there's an indication that the offender does not intend to settle the matter, to make things whole again. So the punishment would only apply to persons who put themselves and keep themselves outside the law. Right? Now, I know punishment rings different bells, so I'm not discussing here questions of deterrence or the use of punishment to discipline and teach, but merely punishment as a response to crime. And with this, I thank you.